This program is brought to you by Emory University.
Well, good evening. I'm Robert Shapiro, the Dean of Emory Law School, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to this wonderful event this evening. I'd like to give a special thanks to our sponsoring firms who have continued their support from last year's inaugural event. Those would be Sutherland and Taylor English. Please join me in thanking them for that. I'd also like to thank Melba Hughes and Major Lindsay in Africa, our partners in this exciting program. All right, please for Melba. Okay. I would like to thank the panelists, great leaders in promoting diversity who are gathered here tonight. We'll be hearing more about them later, but briefly now, we have Ben Garren, the General Counsel North America of the Coca-Cola Company, Cathy Hampton, the Chief Legal Officer, the City of Atlanta, Rick Palmore, General Counsel and Executive Vice President of General Mills, and our moderator, Tom Mars, is a partner at Taylor English Duma and former Executive Vice President and General Counsel of Walmart Stores. I would also like to recognize a special guest that we have here this evening, a distinguished alumna of this law school, Patrice Perkins Hooker, who is the president of the State Bar of Georgia. Thank you very much, Patrice. Now, diversity is an extremely important value for Emory University and Emory Law School. At Emory Law, we seek to advance the rule of law through the students we educate, the ideas we create, the service we perform. Diversity is an essential component of accomplishing this mission. The inclusion of people from diverse backgrounds with diverse perspectives is a critical element of our intellectual community, of the learning in our classrooms, of the insights of our scholarship, the value of our service. Emory has long been a leader in promoting diversity. In 1962, Dean Ben Johnson, Emory Law School class of 1940, Chair of the Board of Trustees, Henry Bowden, Emory Law School class of 1934, brought the lawsuit that allowed the integration of private colleges and universities in Georgia. That suit transformed Georgia. It transformed the legal profession. It was part of a movement that transformed the world. However, diversity must be an ongoing commitment. We honor the achievements of Johnson and Bowden and others, not merely by historical reflection, but by ongoing actions each and every day to make our community diverse and inclusive. Our task is to continue this tradition, to create the reality of diversity in our classrooms, our courtrooms, our boardrooms. That is how we honor our past accomplishments. That's how we ensure our future excellence. That is how we prepare our students for leadership in the global environment of the 21st century. Now, I'm pleased to offer great news of another step in our goal of advancing diversity at Emory Law School. Tomorrow morning, we will be announcing that through the generosity of an anonymous donor, Emory has received a $1.5 million gift toward a John Lewis Chair in Civil Rights and Social Justice. We are indeed very proud of this step. The law school will raise additional matching funds of another $500,000 to fully fund this chair. The gift will enable us to conduct a nationwide search to identify a distinguished scholar with a demonstrated desire to promote the rule of law through the study of civil rights. Through this chair, we are honored to recognize Congressman Lewis's historic achievements, and the chair will be an enduring legacy to inspire the Emory community to continue our ongoing commitment to diversity and to academic excellence. Now, you may be wondering how you can be part of this enduring legacy. Good question. So, if you would like to assist in funding this chair, please get in touch with Associate Dean Joella Rissick. Her contact information is listed in tonight's program. And indeed, we are planning to host an event in the fall to celebrate Congressman Lewis and to recognize those who will be contributing to this chair. We hope we will be able to add your name to the list of supporters. Now I'm pleased to introduce tonight's moderator, Tom Mars of Taylor English. Tom Mars has more than 25 years of combined legal, business, and leadership experience, and is a member of Taylor English's Litigation and Dispute Resolution Practice Group. Prior to joining Taylor English, Mr. Mars was an accomplished trial lawyer, the director of the Arkansas State Police, executive vice president of general counsel of Walmart Stores Incorporated, and executive vice president and chief administrative officer of Walmart U.S. Mr. Mars is a former member of the American Board of Trial Advocates and is a past recipient of the American Bar Association's Spirit of Excellence Award. He received his BA at Arkansas University and his JD from University of Arkansas School of Law, where he was editor-in-chief of the Arkansas Law Review and graduated first in his class. Please join me in welcoming Tom Mars.
Thank you, David. Thank you for that generous introduction. And let me begin by saying, on behalf of the panelists and myself, we are thrilled to be here tonight and just as thrilled that you decided to come and spend your time with us. For those of you who were here last year, or for those of you who, like me, were not, but took advantage of YouTube and reviewed the video of last year's presentation, as any responsible moderator in my role would do, the bar was set extremely high. Our friend Terry McClure did a predictably fantastic job, as did the other panelists. But we didn't want to be outdone just because they set the bar very high last year. So we will endeavor tonight to provide you with just as thought-provoking an experience as you had last year, and maybe, perhaps, to share with you some perspectives that maybe you haven't considered before about this important topic, and then to leave you with a bit of a challenge when we all leave here tonight. I am the moderator after all, but if you'll indulge me, I'm going to spend a few minutes just to get us off to a good start, putting my own perspective on this topic and probably blowing away every preconceived notion you have about how this middle-aged white guy got on some diversity journey and then became seen as a champion for diversity, a label that I'm happy to have. But let me tell you, and I'll be quick about it. I started my career in a closet-sized office next to a well-known law firm partner in Little Rock, Arkansas, in 1985-86, and her name was, she was then known as Hillary Rodham Clinton. And for the first 4 years of my career, I wrote pleadings, received back the red-inked, edited copies that always came back from Hillary, ran documents back and forth from the Rose Firm to the governor's mansion, second-chaired several jury trials, and on occasion when Chelsea, who was then 6 years old, was hungry or wanted a drink, I'd run downstairs and get a snack or soft drink for her. I was, let's not overstate my relationship with Secretary Clinton, I was her grunt, but I think I was a good one, and I saw her recently and she verified that. But looking back on that experience, as I often do, because now you can't read any news without her name appearing, I think it's fair to say, I was saying years ago, before President Clinton even ran for office, that she's the best trial lawyer, actually the best lawyer I've ever been around, and I've been around a lot. So it won't surprise you that when I look back on that experience, I can tell you that I learned, I think, everything that's important about being an effective trial lawyer. But more to the point for tonight, I also learned from Hillary about the importance of lawyers promoting democracy and equality. And I don't remember a single time when she used the word diversity or mentoring, and I don't remember anybody even using the word back then, but I credit her with planting those diversity seeds in my mind some 30 years ago. So about 15 years later, after I'd become a first chair trial lawyer and had more than 20 jury trials under my belt, I got a call from Walmart and joined that company in January of 2002. By that time, and this might surprise you as well, I had become known publicly as a staunch Republican simply because I had represented Governor Mike Huckabee as his lawyer in two political litigation matters, I'll call them that, which he prevailed in, by the way, and I'd also served, sorry, but I couldn't help. I also served as a member of his cabinet for 3 years as the director of the Arkansas State Police, and that's when I started wearing these haircuts. But I didn't see myself as a staunch Republican. I'd never seen myself as clinging to any political party. I've seen myself as somebody who's sort of most of the time in the middle. But on the subject of diversity, I have to tell you, I am embarrassed to admit how shallow my thinking was at the time I joined Walmart. It'd be more accurate, frankly, to say it was non-existent. And as I look back now, I am absolutely certain that I never, seriously, never used the word diversity before January 2002 when I joined Walmart, unless I was drafting a complaint pleading federal jurisdiction. In short, you could have looked far and wide and not have found a more unlikely candidate to be a diversity champion than the fellow that you're looking at tonight. And so during the first year of Walmart, that place was pretty busy. We had the Dukes class action, thousands of lawsuits, hundreds of legal matters, 60 class actions, and I was struggling to keep my head above water. Well, what's that have to do with diversity? Nothing, but this does. There was a second career lawyer named Susan Clues from Michigan, a senior employment lawyer who came by my office regularly during that first year and a half, and she would stick her head in my office and say, she'd always have some little flyer, she'd say, you know, there's this diversity event that I'm gonna go to, you should go with me. Well, my response was pretty standard, in fact, completely standard. Every time I'd say, I'd love to, but I'm struggling with trying to get a handle on what's going on around here. If I had time, I'd go, but I just can't. Fast forward until the summer of 2004. I've been with the company about a year and a half. I'm still struggling. We have 56 lawyers. I'm under pressure to hire a lot more. The headhunters can't get that done. Well, Melba could have, but the ones I was using couldn't get that done at the pace we needed. So, I was really struggling. My assistant Sharon comes into the office in August of 2004 and says, where do you want to stay in Chicago with Susan? And I gave her a blank look, and she comes back and she says, we have a problem. She comes back with a flyer, and I have a copy of it at home today, a flyer announcing in Chicago, Illinois, the American Bar Association Minority Counsel Program featuring yours truly as the guest speaker. And I kid you not. And I went down to Susan's office, and she got off the phone and said something about I'm probably going to get fired. And anyway, I took it in stride as what choice did I have? I mean, everybody had already seen the flyer. And so I went to Chicago on September 30th, the day I began this journey, and never had an experience like that before. I didn't have much to say that was worth listening to, in my opinion, but I remember staying up well past midnight in the bar, frankly, just visiting with some African-American lawyers. Otis McGee, who was a member of ABOTA from the Bay Area, got to know him there. And before I went up to Chicago, I thought if I'm going to go up there, I need to see this guy named Rick Palmore, because at the time, in the spring of 2004, if you'll recall, Rick initiated the call to action. So the next day after this event, I went by Rick's office to keep my appointment. I walked in and noticed immediately two things. First, that his palatial, glassy, museum-looking office was a lot nicer than the one I had in Bentonville. And secondly, that Rick is a very thoughtful, understated guy, not the fist-banging guy I expected to see. So we had a nice conversation. He encouraged me not to sign the call to action unless I was serious about it. I went back to Bentonville, and on the way back on the plane, I said to Susan, let's do that again. And that fall, we went to every Affinity Bar Association meeting that was held that year. And about midway through the fall, I had this amazing epiphany. That is, that all the talent that we needed that we could not find was right there in front of our eyes, and nobody else was tapping into it. And through the NBA, NAPABA, HNBA, I eventually became part of the Leadership Council of all those organizations, and ironically, I became, years later, the chair of the American Bar Association Minority Counsel Program that started me on this journey. Well, listen, folks, we did this in 5 years. We grew a department that had 56 lawyers, all but 16 left the department for various reasons. We ended up with 176 lawyers in Bentonville, and for the last 3 years, more than 35% of those lawyers, super lawyers, were people of color, and almost 50% were women. And my face lit up tonight when I saw Brian and Nicole Henry stand up, because you're also two of the best looking people in the room, two of the most talented lawyers you will ever find that we were able to bring to Bentonville. And we brought Brian in as a senior corporate lawyer. Nicole was, she sort of helped me experiment and understand flex time. Brian went on to become the head of mergers and acquisitions for Walmart worldwide, which, if you might imagine, is not a small job. And I was thrilled to find out, not that he left the company, but that he had moved to Atlanta recently, where he joined General Electric in an equally amazing job. And I used to say all the time, I'm going to say it again right here, Brian, I would always find excuses to take Brian with me to board meetings anywhere, because he always made me look better. And so anyway, I share that story with you, and I'll close by this saying this, and then we'll go to the panel. I read recently in a New York Times story, you should look for it, it's called The Moral Bucket List, that there are virtues, those are virtues you bring to the marketplace, and there are eulogy virtues, and those are the things that you are remembered for. And as Brian and Nicole can attest, nobody remembers me at Walmart for the fact that the Duke's class action got dismissed by the United States Supreme Court. Well, maybe somebody does, but I'm not remembered for anything I brought, if I brought anything at all in terms of skill sets. But I took so much away. That was a life-changing experience for me. It made me a better leader. It made me a better lawyer. And the people who know me the best, including my wife, would tell you it made me a better person. It changed my way of thinking and opened up a network of relationships that's probably unlike any relationship network that anyone in this room has. I mean, I may be the only person on the planet who's worked for both Hillary Clinton and Mike Huckabee directly. And last fall, the conference board asked me to arrange some speakers at the chief legal officer meeting, and I moderated a discussion, it was fascinating, between two close friends of mine that I got to know for very different reasons. Mac McClarty, Bill Clinton's best friend since kindergarten and the first chief of staff in the Clinton White House, and Haley Barbour. Now, can you imagine how interesting that discussion was? And as a result of all of these relationships, and other things, I say to people all the time, and I say it to my partners, diversity is the gift that keeps on giving. And one of the panelists last year said, once you get started, and he's a guy that looks like me, you can't stop. And just last Thursday, I spoke to a group of about 25 women lawyers in an organization called the Stiletto Network. I'm not sure about the name, but and it wasn't a bar, but it was a private room. But I can tell you the feedback was terrific, and the feedback just fueled me to go do this again and again and again. But if you're not convinced, especially if you're a guy who looks like me, if you're not convinced that this is important as a lawyer, that there's a business case, that there's all kinds of justifications for it, consider this. In my cell phone, I can call, and if he doesn't answer, I'll get a call back promptly from the person who's the treasurer of the Clinton campaign, from the highest placed person in the Jeb Bush, it's not a campaign yet, from the same people in the Mike Huckabee campaign, and from Reverend Al Sharpton. And for those of you who look like me, you're rolling your eyes right now, because most times that's what I get, and you're wondering, like, what's the value of being able to call Reverend Al Sharpton? Well, I have a 10-year trust relationship with him. And that's a longer story than you need to hear tonight, but consider this. If you have a client or you know, if you're Ben Garren and your client is your the company you work for, and you're in a high-profile company or you're representing one and they get in a jam in some PR mess like often happens when you least expect it, and Reverend Al Sharpton's about ready to go on CNN and rake your company over the coals, wouldn't it be nice to be able to call him and have a 10-year trust relationship? Well, I know some people who think that's of value because from time to time I get calls like that. Alexis Herman is another person I met. Shirley Franklin. I met so many people, and Magic Johnson, and the list goes on and on. So if I haven't inspired you, I don't know what else to say. But I would leave you with this challenge, and then we're going to begin the panel questions, and I think they'll fit very nicely with my little story. This is the challenge. When you wake up in the morning and your feet hit the floor, make a commitment to do something, especially if you're somebody who looks like me. And if you can't figure out another place to start, go be a Susan Clues. Go be a courageous Susan Clues for some general counsel who just needed somebody to lead him to water. Because if it weren't for Susan Clues, my career would have been very different at Walmart, and I sure wouldn't be standing here. And if you're not going to do that, go. If you're a senior lawyer, I know Paul Murphy's here from King & Spalding, somebody I've gotten to know recently. People like Paul, you have enough stature, you can go be a Hillary Clinton for some young legal mind, impressionable legal mind like I had so many years ago. So that concludes my story. I want to move on into the questions, and the first one will tie very nicely into that. For the whole panel, various rationales have been offered to bolster the importance of advancing diversity in the legal profession, and they include what I'll call democracy rationale, often referred to as doing the right thing, the traditional business case or demographics rationale, that is, our workforce should look like and understand the unique challenges of our customer base segment, and the one that I advocate more than any other. I call it the how to get the best talent rationale. So let me ask the members of our distinguished panel, does it matter what rationale the leader of an organization is offering for advancing diversity? And if so, why? Rick,
okay.
I could have sworn you were reaching for your microphone.
I don't mind going first. Sometimes ladies do go first, right?
Very good point.
First of all, good evening, and thank you all so much for being here, and a special thanks to all the sponsors, and certainly to Dean Shapiro, who sent a lot of great lawyers to my shop. It certainly matters what the model is, because it sets the tone for the strategy. So if you have someone in charge who helps you think through the strategy, then the decisions that you make will just follow from that. So certainly it matters. And as for me, the one that I find that makes the most sense is the one that I can quantify. And that's around the success of good candidates and finding the best talent. So any strategies you have around getting the best talent and being able to quantify how that looks and what success metrics that you're using, that's the kind of business case that's more likely to be sustainable rather than something that's a little bit more warm and fuzzy.
So when it comes to leading people who look like me to diversity water, as Susan did for me in hopes that they'll take a drink, which rationale in your experience has been more effective than others? Ben?
I think it's particularly powerful at our company to be able to align our legal diversity strategy with the business strategy of the company. And even though all of the justifications that you've mentioned are, I think they're all valid, but that one really helps, I think, to get people behind it, people who may not sort of have been involved in diversity before, or may not, be active in the NBA or some of the other organizations, and say, okay, well, how do I get behind this? And it's not a hard case to make. I mean, it's the multicultural segment is about at the last statistic I've seen, about $3.2 trillion in buying power in the U.S. But the multicultural segment by 2020 will be about 40% of the population, and by 2040, I've seen statistics say 49-50% of the population. So, and such a significant percentage of our future growth for the company is going to be from the multicultural segment. It's just imperative that we have a strategy against and that aligns with that segment. And part of our strategy is to making sure that we have a leadership that is sensitive to diversity, that is a diverse leadership, and that our organizations that support the company, including our legal function, are diverse. So, I mean, it's as simple as you don't want guys like us, right, making decisions about what a young Hispanic woman is going to think is cool, right? So,
for sure.
And as I said, once you can begin to talk and align your diversity strategies with your company's business strategy, just like we want all of our lawyers to understand the strategy of the company, to get behind them, to support them, to protect them, we find pretty quickly that people sort of get energized by that. So,
Rick?
So Tom, let me point out that Susan Clues was sneaky.
She was.
And you didn't share with us, I'm sure there was a pitch behind her invitations to have you participate in these events, but she was successful because she was sneaky. And so she got in the door and got you in the door because she was sneaky. Now, I agree with what my panelists have said, but there's a part of me that says, I don't really care how I get in the door. What I do after I get in the door is really important. But how I get in the door, it can make a difference. But if my choice is, do I get in the door or do I stand outside with the right reason, I want to be in the door. So, not suggesting there's a right answer, but just a thought starter here.
That's a great response, Rick, and no surprise coming from you. In fact, the next question is exclusively for Rick by the panel's prior agreement. For those of you who don't know this, there's not a single lawyer on the planet today who's been more active, effective, committed, influential, relentless in advancing diversity in the legal profession than Rick Palmore. And he deserves a little round of applause because he flew in here from Chicago and confronted tornadoes in Atlanta, Georgia to be here tonight. He says he didn't know the tornadoes were here until he landed, but that's really, between us, Rick. But Rick is in a really unique position to provide an overview of the history of organized efforts in this area, and I've asked him to give you that overview, going back to the work that Charles Morgan did, his own call to action, and the Leadership Council on Legal Diversity that Rick then started in 2009, which I was a part of for a short period before I became the Chief Administrative Officer at Walmart. Rick, can you share that history with us?
So I think Tom's trying to make me look older than I actually am. No, I'm just kidding. So the work in this area obviously has been going on for many, many years, and it predates even this. But I recall receiving a call years and years ago when I was in private practice from someone who was on Harry Pierce's staff at General Motors. And Harry Pierce had authored a letter that he sent out. He was then the general counsel to law firms, advising those firms that he was very interested in having diverse lawyers represent General Motors in matters that were going to be in court. And so as a part of that effort, I was fortunate enough to receive a call, which I thought was out of the blue. It turned out it was not out of the blue, asking me if I'd be interested in coming to Detroit to chat with Mr. Pierce about the possibility of representing General Motors. And I think before the phone hit the cradle, I was at the airport. But folks like Harry Pierce, who led the charge, and this was in the 1980s, set the groundwork for the work that came later. And that spawned a lot of great work that occurred with the American Bar Association and the Minority Demonstration Project. And then, as Tom has referenced, Charles Morgan, and this was through the auspices of the ABA, authored a missive, if you will, that was encouraging, and he solicited a large number of general counsels of major companies to manifest the interest of those general counsel of those companies in diversity, to urge, once again, law firms to hire, develop, promote diverse lawyers. I don't remember what the numbers are now, but a remarkable number of general counsel of an unbelievable roster of companies signed that letter. And you would think that might be the end of the story. Unfortunately, it wasn't. And it just demonstrates how tenacious this challenge is. The needle moved, but not very much, and not nearly enough. I will confess that I found myself becoming more frustrated by the absence of action. Now, that's not to be critical of anyone, but as Dean Shapiro commended us to do, to take action, I decided that I needed to take action. Part of it was I was sitting on a panel much like this in Chicago and before an audience that was not as diverse as this one is. All of the panelists were urging everyone there to do something, to take some steps. And I was walking back to my office and I started having one of those conversations with myself. I know nobody else in the audience does that, right? And the question that I asked myself was, okay, Palmore, you said some great things, maybe even some provocative things on that panel. What are you actually doing? And out of that came the call to action. I decided that what I was prepared to do was to author something that had what I thought was a little more teeth in it, that said, not only are we as general counsel interested, and we commend our firms to actually pursue diversity and diverse talent, but if you don't, then we are prepared to take action as a consequence, and we will consider your diversity performance in selecting firms to do our work and promoting firms. And I'm pleased to say over 100 general counsel signed on to that letter, not nearly as many who signed on to the statement of principle, which tells you that there was still work to be done and there remains work to be done today, because even though one would think, as Ben suggested, that it's an easy case to make, apparently we haven't made it well enough.
Can you tell the audience a little bit about the Leadership Council on Legal Diversity, which, as I said to Rick recently, I worried about its future, and I learned he was retiring from General Mills, but was heartened to find out from Rick that Brad Smith, the general counsel of Microsoft, has assumed that leadership responsibility of that organization, which I think has now more than 220 members.
Yes, it does, actually. Well, the Leadership Council on Legal Diversity, for those of you who are not familiar with it, I recommend that you go on the internet and find out about it. It's a terrific organization. There's at least one fellow from the program who's in the audience tonight who introduced herself to me, which is a terrific talent development program. Anyway, LCLD came out of the call to action. The group that eventually came to be focused on the call to action decided that we really wanted to take the next step. There was no organization behind the call to action. It was a group of individuals that were deeply committed to advancing this cause. And we wanted to make this effort sustainable. And unfortunately, we concluded, and I say unfortunately because we all had day jobs, we concluded that in order to do that, we needed to form an organization. And for a whole host of reasons that I won't go into tonight, we didn't want to latch on to an existing organization. We wanted to start our own and attack this from a different angle. And over the course of time, we concluded that just having companies engaged in the effort, pointing the finger at law firms, was not the most effective way to do it. That we really needed to be in the room with the firms, having those tough conversations, taking some of the weight ourselves, and trying to figure out how we could accomplish what we needed to accomplish was the way to go. And so from the call to action, we had a almost a revival meeting in Arizona, and we invited firms and companies to have a full and frank conversation about diversity. No media were invited because we wanted it to be full and frank. We wanted no posturing and for the cameras. And we did have that conversation. Out of that grew LCLD. And I have to tell you that when we formed LCLD, it was controversial. Hardly anybody liked it, if I'm honest. Those who are opposed to diversity said, oh no, not another one. Some folks who are in the diversity field said, oh no, not another one. But I'm proud to say, not just that the organization is thriving, now that it is more than 5 years old, but that there are close to 250 members, and more importantly, we are helping to develop the next generation of leaders for talent development, whatever it looks like, of whatever stripe.
Tom, if I could just add to that.
Yes, ma'am.
And Rick, I want to thank you for your leadership in this area. When we began to really formalize our program at the Coca-Cola Company, it was about in 2005, and one of the first things we did was to sign on to the call to action. And you know, at that point in time, Rick was leading in the area, and there were several other companies who were sort of out in front: DuPont, Pfizer. You mentioned General Motors and Walmart. Tom, you were doing some very provocative things. And you know, when we set about formalizing our program, we really tried to come up with focus areas. We wanted to look at supplier diversity and how to increase our spend with women and minority-owned businesses. We were looking at how we would, how we created a pipeline and how we supported affinity groups. How we were going to deal with our law firms and encourage diversity. But the thing we really recognized is we needed to get our own house in order first. We needed to take a good look at ourselves before we could expect, others to follow. And, I'll quote some statistics because I think we may have you beat at Walmart. But anyway, for women now at the Coca-Cola Company, women in our U.S. lawyers account for about 48%. And we have 35% minority representation in our attorneys.
I'll tell you what. Those numbers would have been hard to find back 10 years ago. That's really impressive.
But it really was. Again, I come back to the leadership that Rick and Tom and those of you out there who kind of served as mentors for our company. And there's still, as you said, though, there's still much work to be done. And if unfortunately, I think the recession took a bit of a toll on some of the ground that we were making. But hopefully, we're clawing that back. But
Well, let me move into some perhaps a little uncomfortable territory, because I was there at that meeting in Arizona years ago and remember some of these conversations. Fortune companies and government entities, we all know, especially those with large books of outside counsel business, can and sometimes do use their commercial influence on law firms to encourage them, I'll use that word, to be more supportive of diversity initiatives or to meet certain diversity goals in the hiring, retention, and advancement of women lawyers and lawyers of color, gay and lesbian lawyers and lawyers with disabilities. I've heard this referred to as the carrot and stick approach. The bigger the outside counsel budget, the bigger the carrot, and the bigger the stick. There's much to talk about here, but Cathy, I'd like to first ask you, do government CLOs have the same latitude in this area as the CLOs of Fortune 100 companies?
Absolutely. I would argue even more so because of the level of media scrutiny, that what we do is so transparent, and you can find our spend just by clicking online. So when you have that kind of transparency around your spend, then everyone can see where your money is going. So that puts even more pressure on how you spend the money. And then the other side of that is that the folks who are working with you and they win, there's so much more media coverage of your cases, of your transactions. So you're not only able to use the lever of the spend, but the lever of the media coverage. And they're both equally effective when you're trying to affect change with your stakeholders.
Well, I'm sure that Rick and Ben would have something to say about this, but Cathy, since you're on a roll, let me ask you your opinion on, I actually guess I don't need to ask if you think the use of commercial influence in that manner is appropriate. You made that pretty clear, but let me ask, does it work? And if so, when and how is it most effective? But you have some stories to share.
Certainly, and I won't tell too many stories. In a taped room, but I can share.
Oh, we're taped?
I know. But I can tell you that money alone doesn't work. There are so many other sources of business that what I find most effective is walking the walk, that the change starts with me. So for me to be able to show my staff numbers and the performance metrics of how we win with those numbers, that's much more powerful. So asking a law firm to do something that I'm not willing to do first, that's not an effective argument. A check alone won't work. And also using our relationships. Ben and I sit on a committee together of the state bar and we have these conversations. So it's not just the money, it's not just what you do, but it's also that peer pressure where we talk among ourselves about how we're doing. I believe when you put all of those factors together, that's when you get to move that needle. But one alone, just writing the check, just isn't enough if you're not walking that walk.
Ben?
Yeah. It's interesting, you talk about the carrot and the stick approach, and we follow very closely at the time. I mean, what you were doing at Walmart, which was very much, I would say there was a lot of stick in that. we weren't quite as comfortable going there. I think maybe because we were newer to it, we weren't quite as overt. Although I must tell you, there are situations where we made decisions on whether to use a firm or not, because their diversity practices have certainly been a tiebreaker between two firms that we have used and who would have been qualified to handle a matter. But we've also tried very much the carrot approach to try to make sure we're holding out those firms who do a great job in the diversity space. And one thing we're very proud of, and we've been doing this since 2008. It was really started by John Lewis, our John Lewis, who was our kind of first chair of our legal department diversity council, and Kamala Alexander's here, who has now succeeded John. John has gone on to become our chief diversity officer for the Coca-Cola company globally. So we're very proud of John and what that also says about our work in the legal division around diversity. But the one thing John developed for us was our Living the Values Award. So each year we send out to our firms a pretty pretty lengthy questionnaire about their diversity statistics with some tough questions in it, you know, questions about, okay, because everybody, you know, can do a good marketing job and point you in the direction they want you, but we try to probe to find out how deep it goes. Questions like, you know, what's your least diverse practice area and why is that so and what are you doing about it? Or, okay, how many diverse or women lawyers do you have beyond the sixth year? Those sorts of things. And then we, you know, we do we have a committee that selects that firm, and then, you know, we pick the firm at Living the Values Award, and then we celebrate that firm. Often, you know, we've had the chairman of the company to come and spend some time with that firm and that sort of thing. So, it, you know, it really, and as I think, Cathy, you made a great point about, you know, not only do they get the opportunity to spend time with our lawyers, not only, you know, not only are we calling them out among their peer group, but it's something we, you know, that at counsel and at companies talk about, firms that are, you know, in line with the values of most of our companies. So.
Well, that's terrific. Rick, do you have anything to add on this topic?
I'd just say there's power in, well, I'll point out a couple of things. Both Cathy started it and Ben chimed in, but there's one word that Cathy in particular used that I think is important here, and that's winning. So, you know, it is important that we be diverse, but at the end of the day, we need to tie that to the fact that we're winning. So she's in a very public spot with lots of transparency. If she's losing all the time, then the power of that pulpit is diminished significantly. So at the end of the day, and this comes back to something, Tom, that you said earlier, diversity is really about having the best talent and the best team. I like to win. When I was a general counsel at Sara Lee and a general counsel at General Mills, I had a fiduciary responsibility that I needed to fulfill. And so my pursuit of diversity was really the pursuit of talent and was in fulfillment of that fiduciary obligation. That's the point that often gets overlooked when we talk about this subject. And it is perhaps the most important aspect of it. I can assure you that when Tom Morris came to my office that on October 1st, 2004, I didn't remember that date,
I sure do.
That one of the words that I used when we were talking about diversity was winning. Because that's what I want to do in whatever my endeavor is. And so when you've got somebody who's in a position to say, hey, I just got this new matter for the city of Atlanta. It can be for $10. It speaks larger than the dollar amount. I've got this matter for the Coca-Cola company. That's a resume enhancer. And if Ben and Cathy are talking to each other, oh my goodness. Now flip the script. Cathy says, you know what? I'm not going to use that firm that much anymore because they're not after this talent piece. And then Cathy talks to Ben. Ben talks to Tom. That reverberates as well. So I'm a huge proponent of the carrot. That's my preferred avenue. But occasionally, I'm just saying, okay?
I think it's probably a good time to get down in the weeds a little bit and share with the audience, and this is not a prepared question, but I know you don't need a prepared question. Could you share with the audience some best practices that you've experienced, and if you'd like, some practices that you tried but maybe abandoned? I personally could share several in both categories. Cathy?
Sure. We had talked about unconscious bias in one of our earlier conversations, and everybody has it. So how do you mitigate the risk of that overtaking your hiring? We found that having group interviews where you have a mix of lawyers interviewing, that really teases out the best candidates in a way that one person one-on-one couldn't do alone. So I use an example of when I was at Earthlink, I hired someone who was a great Alta player and we were going to be on a tennis team together. Now, if that's not unconscious bias, I don't know what is. I mean, she had a great resume, don't get me wrong, but we went on a tennis tangent, and I can't tell you how many cases she first chaired or second chaired because I thought she reflected me. Now, if someone had looked at this blonde woman from Tennessee and I'm this black woman from Mississippi, they wouldn't have seen the bias at work. But because I know we were tennis sisters at heart, then she was my number one candidate. And so I use that as an example of if sometimes if we're left to our own devices, we find folks who affirm what we like most about ourselves. But by having the group interviews, and I have a couple of my lawyers here with me, we can attest that that leads to a robust debate about who's the right person, the right fit, and we also apply that to promotions and performance metrics. So I find having a group involved in the hiring really helps us in terms of best practices instead of the one-on-one where consciously or not, you end up with folks who will play tennis with you.
Ben?
Yeah, I'll just comment on the area of you know, what's worked for us in some areas. I'd mentioned one of our pillars that we were focusing on when we started our journey. It was, you know, one of them was supplier diversity, increasing our spend with minority women on businesses. And one of the things that's worked very well for us is to, you know, we have what we call our straight talk meeting. We invite in minority women on businesses, representatives of those, and our legal function, just come and spend some time. No promises that there'll be work coming, but just have an opportunity to meet these people, understand their practice areas, where they practice, what their experience, and begin to make some connections, and also to make sure we have the right sort of turnout. Our folks really enjoy that, and we have, you know, we're not able to promise that everybody that comes is going to get work. In fact, probably a small percentage, but some people do, and we've added to our roster of firms through those contacts. Another thing that's very important, you know, is kind of the old saying, you know, what gets measured gets done. The other thing we put against our supplier diversity efforts is basically to put some percentages against what we wanted to increase our spend with minority and women-owned businesses by 20% a year until we reached our target goal. And now we're at about 10% of our spend with women and minority-owned businesses. But one thing that Rick said through that, you know, this hasn't just been an altruistic exercise for us. I mean, we have found great lawyers. And oftentimes at these firms, they're smaller firms, oftentimes at really competitive rates as well. So but first I would say some of the finest lawyers that we work with, we've been able to identify. And, you know, had we not had these programs, we have our go-to firms, relationships are in place, you get a matter, you know, you don't have time to begin to interview people at that point that you haven't worked with before, you've just got to go to a firm. So I think these programs have allowed us to really identify some terrific professionals.
Jeff Gearhart, who I think all of you know, succeeded me as general counsel at Walmart, tells a story when he's speaking on these panels about being in my office and telling me that I remember it the same way, that he couldn't find any lawyers of color or women lawyers who were qualified for whatever corporate position or positions he was trying to fill, and conversation became animated, as we both recall, and I said to him calmly, you're not looking hard enough, or you're not looking in the right places. And sure enough, following our motto, not to confuse efforts with results, before long, Jeff found terrific candidates, and we were able to bring on people like Brian and Nicole Henry. Can the three of you just comment on this issue of people looking only in traditional places and then wondering why they're only finding people who look like me?
Well, you know, before we get to that, Tom, I'd like to step a half step back and come back to looking in the traditional places, because Cathy referenced unconscious bias, which is a loaded phrase. But what it really means is everyone comes to the party looking at things through the lens that they have. And we all come to things with expectations. So I was at a program where a law professor from UCLA was talking about this subject. And he said, now when you think about trial lawyer, what do you see? What image pops into your head? And he suggested, I think he's right, that for most folks, the image of the trial lawyer is somebody who's 6'2", probably about 55 years old, little gray hair, white male, with a deep voice. Now, the professor who was saying this is Asian American. He's about 5'8". He probably weighs about 165 pounds. He doesn't look anything like that. And he said specifically, you think of trial lawyer, my physical image is not what pops in your head. So you could be looking, not you, but his point was, one could be looking in the traditional spot and see him and not see that trial lawyer. So I do think it's important to look more broadly, but let's not give a pass to how we're looking in the traditional places either. That's the half step I wanted to take back.
Well, that's why we brought you all the way from Chicago, Rick. That's a great perspective. Not that any law firm partners would actually say this to you, but suppose hypothetically they were saying behind your back, complaining that some corporate law departments have taken a do as I say, not as I do approach, that they've not really kept their commitments to law firms who have gone the extra mile in advancing diversity. Instead, they keep giving the same high-quality business to firms who really haven't done anything in that area. And worse yet, some of these corporate law departments are using their most diversity-driven law firms as poaching grounds for hiring lawyers and bringing them from the law firm into the company. There are a lot of people in this room, myself included, who've heard all those criticisms, and none of them were directed at any of the companies here or the city of Atlanta. But those criticisms are out there. Ben, what would you say?
Some of that is fair, I think. The first part of it, I think law firms should expect, if there's a corporate in-house law department that is pushing them hard on diversity, they ought to, you ought to, as you said, the first thing we did is try to take care of our own department, mm-hmm. Before we made demands of others. So I think that's fair. The issue about, I'm not getting work, I think we ought to be calling out, either stick or carrot, we ought to be calling out great work in the diversity space. Now, when it comes to, hiring, we can't maintain diverse lawyers because, they get hired away. I don't buy that. We do hire away diverse lawyers. We always hire away the brightest and best lawyers at some of the firms, and we never hear that, we can't find other bright lawyers because you hired them away. I just don't think that one, I just don't think that holds. And also, I think most law firms view that as a good thing to have their lawyers in house.
You would think so, right?
And it works both ways. I was poached by two law firms in the past 60 days. So be clear that it goes both ways in terms of the poaching. And I always see it as a badge of honor. It means we're doing something right if folks want the products that we're training. But I also think there's something to be said about the pipeline, that if you look at law schools, those numbers are reflected in law firms. So it's also worth directing efforts at that college pipeline. And that's the kind of conversation I've been having with firms since I started as a young associate. One of the issues we found at Sherman and Sterling many moons ago, because I was the only black person in a class of 60, was that we weren't seeing the numbers because we weren't helping to create the numbers. So there is a responsibility to go to colleges, which is where we started, and that's one of our initiatives as well in terms of best practices, that the more folks you encourage to go to law school, then you're increasing the pool. And so that was one of the pushes we had when I was a young associate at Sherman and Sterling, and I've continued that best practice because that's a way to start the pool, is to go talk to sophomores and juniors about being a lawyer, allowing them to come shadow us, to go to court for a day. internships, summer associate programs, those are the ways to increase the pool so that you have that broader pool of talent. But I must say the poaching goes both ways. And I started with saying it's the change starts with us, and I think that's worth repeating, that we're not asking law firms to do anything that we're not willing to do.
Cathy, do you think that part of the opportunity here is that law firms sometimes develop the mindset that this is an immediate gratification program? That, I mean, I remember specifically having a law firm say, you know, we've made a lot of progress, and then described that they really had many progress, but they've been trying really hard. And then another firm in that same firm saying things that made you think that they thought that the, you know, first lawyer of color who became partner entitled them to, you know, another $250,000 worth of business in the next fiscal quarter or something. You know, I got the impression over time that law firms might think this is a short-term strategy, whereas I learned from my perspective it was a long-term strategy. What do you think?
No, absolutely. And reminding firms that it's good business practices for them. You're not doing me a favor, you're doing yourself a favor by getting the best talent. So I always push back on that idea of you're getting lesser talent. I would argue you're getting better talent by widening that pool, because you don't know if the best trial lawyer for this particular case is someone you haven't met yet. So by widening the pool, that's better for the firm, not just for us. And just reminding folks that this is good business, not just the warm and the fuzzy. So if you're thinking for the long-term growth of your law firm, then you need to start thinking about policies and practices that keep folks from being poached and vice versa. So it's a short-term game, but it's also a long-term one in terms of your strategic planning and your business plan for your firm.
Rick and Ben, have you received that kind of feedback from suggesting that there should be an immediate reward?
You might say yes. So, you know, some of the things that I've heard over the years are frankly incredible. I mean, I've had someone who was so bold as to asked the question, and I think it was phrased just this way: if we hire some, will you send us some business? So, you know, that had an impact, by the way, on their business flow, but.
Well, you know, as you said, sometimes the stick is necessary. I unfortunately remember experience like it was yesterday. I think it was around 2007. We had some kind of outside counsel conference. I was answering questions. Brian, I think you were there, and some lawyer from Philadelphia went to the microphone and said with a straight face in front of all these people, more people than there are in this room, you do realize, don't you, that if we comply with your request to hire lawyers of color, although I think he referred to them as minority lawyers, you're going to see a decrease in the talent of your outside lawyers. And I mean, I was speechless. I don't remember what I said, but you could have heard a pin drop in the room. And I remember a week or so later, Sam Reeves and I were traveling down here to Atlanta, and I asked Sam if he'd fired that law firm yet, and he fired them while we were here in Atlanta. So I thought that was an appropriate use of the stick. People say things that are just totally offensive and inappropriate.
Well, you know, to that point, Tom, I think that integrity in the process is critical. When I joined Sara Lee, or when I joined General Mills, or whatever environment I'm in, my staff is looking at me to see, okay, how are we going to handle this? Is this diversity at all costs? Is that the primary principle here, or are we looking for talent? And they don't phrase it that way. They're just watching to see what I do. By the same token, the elephant in the room is the question that you just that was raised by that lawyer that you're talking about. That in order to become diverse, compromise is necessary. And I would suggest that's still the elephant in the room. I don't know that that's history. And I think that's a large part of why I think integrity throughout this whole process is critical.
I see that we're near the point in time where I should turn this over to Melba, but since we're here at the Emory Law School in this beautiful auditorium, and of course we have much more material than we could possibly cover in the allotted time, Dean, I did want to ask our panelists one or two questions related to legal education in America on the subject of diversity. A recent ABA report suggested that the legal profession's unique role in advancing democracy and promoting equality should become a central component of the professional responsibility curricula in American law schools. Your thoughts?
And I'll take that. I certainly wouldn't oppose that. I think the earlier you can introduce the topics and the kinds of issues we've talked about to young lawyers, you know, the better. I worry that it becomes a box ticking exercise at that. But well, we've done that, you know, because there's so much more nuance to the debate, and we've just talked about, you know, sustainability is the key. How do you drive sustainable? So it needs to be more than, you know, simply a we've done this course, so we've met that requirement.
Cathy, you concur?
No, absolutely.
Rick?
I do as well. I mean, it's I think it the it needs to be part a more holistic approach to it is I think would be much more productive.
Mm-hmm. Well, ladies and gentlemen, at this point, I will turn the podium over to Melba Hughes, although there she is.
Tom?
Melba, before I step down, I want to thank
Tom, real quickly, but just yes. One more point, real quickly. It's,
sure.
It's to tell someone about an article. If you all have an opportunity, there's a piece that was commissioned by McKinsey & Company called Why Diversity Matters by Vivian Hunt. She's a manager in the UK. And they have quantitative data around these issues that I believe will be really helpful for you. Why Diversity Matters, January 2015, McKinsey and Company. It's excellent. And I highly, highly recommend that piece because there's a lot of analysis around the business results of diversity.
Well, thank you for sharing that with us, Cathy. Melba, I just wanted to say in front of our audience that you put in countless hours of efforts to make this happen. 2 years now in a row, and personally, I'm grateful that you reached out to me and allowed me to participate tonight. Thank you.
It feels high up here. Thank you so much for coming tonight. I'm Melba Hughes, and I'm with Major Lindsay in Africa. We're a legal search consulting firm, and some of my colleagues are here who helped me with this program. I think each of you got a personal invite from either me or somebody in my office, so I want to thank my colleagues for helping us. Just as importantly, I want to thank Rick and Cathy and Ben and Tom. It's really fun putting together a panel like this, and they absolutely said yes. Some of them had to clear their calendars. Poor Cathy had to leave an event early tonight where she was actually working on television. But she made it here on time, so we are very, very grateful to them. But before I take some questions, and we're going to give you an opportunity to ask some questions, I also wanted to thank the dean of the law school. I said this last year when we approached him about partnering to do an event around diversity. He said, absolutely yes, I want to do this. And I'd like you to give him a round of applause. It takes a lot of courage, a whole lot of courage, to say yes to something new and different. And we really, really appreciate you, Dean. Thank you. I also want to thank our sponsors again, Sutherland Asbill and Brennan and Taylor English and Duma are firms that have been consistent emotional supporters, but they've also been strong financial supporters, and we appreciate both of those firms. The food that was provided tonight, the opportunity to interact with each other, is only here because of those two firms, so thank you very much. So I think we have an opportunity about maybe 10 minutes or so, Susan? Five. There's the real boss. have you ask questions. We'd appreciate it if you'd go to the mics. We have two mics in the back. Please do ask questions of the panelists.
Yeah, this is just a general question. I'm on the faculty in the medical school, and I'd written this book, Doc Hollywood. We made it into a movie a long time ago, and we were trying to make this movie, The Corporate Kid, and it's about a poor black kid who turns around a rich, greedy white CEO and makes him a good person. And there's a lot of interest, but there's a fella who started this wonderful nonprofit that I think Coke has got interest in the White House to give poor kids a chance by giving them a few shares of stock and letting them go to a shareholders meeting and learn how the business world works. And I don't think anybody, Democrat or Republican, would be against that. And since we've seen this tremendous, all these issues going on today that have to do with, you know, the police issues in Ferguson and everything, it would be, do you think, you know, having this a poor black kid on these ethical missions and giving shares of stock to kids and generating resources so maybe some of them could go to a board meeting at Walmart and contribute and also learn how the business world works? Do you think that could become a movement? The guy who started this nonprofit came from a very poor background. He was a drug dealer because he was smart, and that was the only business he knew how to get into. But then he got out of it and ended up starting this nonprofit. And I just wondered out of curiosity whether you think the business community might be open to that sort of thing.
Yeah, first of all, I'm not authorized to give any stock away, so I'll say that out front. But I would say I think anytime you can have an outreach program to youth, I think that's a good thing. One thing that we do, and Cathy was talking earlier about the pipeline and the work that she's been involved in going into law schools and. You know, we've also been very involved with the street law program, where you actually go into high schools in Atlanta and work with the students there and bring them over to our company, and we have our lawyers meet with them and really try to get them interested in the practice of law and to find out how the different ways you can practice law. And also a bit about what our company does and what it's like to work for a company like ours. And that's been a really rewarding program. We have been following some of those folks as some of them have made their way through law school and keeping up with them. But it's also, I think we get a lot more from it than we give, because it just is very rewarding to be able to talk about our profession and hopefully, get kids interested in it, because it's all about the pipeline. So.
Hi, I wanted to ask a question to Mr. Palmer. Is that right, Palmore?
Tell us who you are.
I'm Patrice Perkins Hooker.
Thank you, Patrice.
Emory alum. I have a question about the impact of the focus on diversifying majority law firms on the decline of the number of 100% minority-owned firms. They seem to have been declining and going away, and as a partner, at a former one of those, I'm wondering what's the trade-off and how do we preserve and protect some of the economic viability in our community?
It's a great question. Thank you for that. My perspective is there isn't a trade-off. I've never viewed this as either or. While I was both at Sara Lee and at General Mills, while steadfastly pursuing the initiatives that you've heard about tonight, we had very strong commitments to minority and women-owned law firms. There were a number of companies, and I think the companies represented here at this table, and we didn't have any government entities with us, unfortunately we should have, were part of those initiatives, as I recall them, at both companies, where companies committed specific large dollar amounts to continue to develop and use minority and women-owned law firms. So, you know, I think that it is tempting, not only in this respect, but in other respects, for people to say, oh, it's either or, and there's not enough to go around. That is absolutely not true.
Yes.
In fact, just to go a step further, we've also asked some of the bigger firms that we've used to partner with smaller women-owned and minority firms to take it an extra step, because some of the work we have, you just need to get your foot in the door to see how it goes. You know, if you think through work at the airport or with our water utility, that's such a niche that it's really hard for someone to get up to speed alone. So we're also looking for ways to partner minority and women-owned firms with some of the larger firms to do some of that kind of work.
Antonio Thomas, class of 69, Emory. I have been dealing with this question of diversity since finishing here and going into civil rights work, although it wasn't called that. And what I'm beginning to understand is that the definition as you see it has changed or is changing depending on where you are and what you're doing. For example, any firm that genuinely wants non-white, non-male lawyers can find them if they want to. But I think part of the problem that I see is that they are looking for those lawyers whom they can mold into their culture, the way they are doing things. And if you do that, I ask whether or not you have diversity. I have been dealing with this issue of judges on the bench, including politicking with the president and a few other places. And what we're finding is that you might have non-white, non-male on the bench. However, the diversity is not there. For example, in appointments, the powers that be are looking for people who will do what has normally been done. Sentencing is tough. That's why you got so many people in jail. Discretion is not going to minorities or whatever. So there's actually very little discretion. And I don't have to talk about the Supreme Court, because the people in my community will make the statement that there is no non-white person on the bench. So I think that when you look at the question of diversity, you're looking at it more than just color. You have to look at it in terms of, and although it was stated in terms of winning and some other things, if you're really looking at diversity, cultural changes and approaches, and how are you going to deal with the major problems that we are facing in a different sort of way and still fit into the culture of that law firm. The law firm wants people who are going to maintain the culture that they have, do things that way. And then if you get that, do you have real diversity?
We're going to take that as a statement.
Is that real diversity?
Would anybody like to comment?
Sorry, I can't resist. Yeah.
You're chomping.
The point you're making is an important one. I said the point you're making is an important one, and it's a fair point. But I disagree with your conclusion. So these organizations are, and there are certainly some organizations that don't want diversity, no matter what the color, sexual orientation, gender is. You get no argument from me about that. But there are many organizations that want their talent to thrive, and they recognize the value of diversity. So I've been in many of these institutions throughout the course of my career, and I think you'd be hard-pressed to find anybody who said, okay, Palmore fit into a box, and I'm not unique. And if at the end of the day, people are recognizing that what they really want is to win and have diversity in points of view, because that's what we're talking about, then that's what's going to carry the day.
Thanks, Rick.
Hi, I'm Meredith Hobbs, and I cover the legal community for the Daily Report, which, Rick, is the legal paper here in Atlanta. I've talked to you before. And so my question is from my own anecdotal experience. As a reporter, I often have lawyers call me up and say, hey, you should write a story about me. I'm changing firms, or I ride a unicycle, or I do this cool thing. And so, like, write a story about me and put my picture in the Daily Report. And P.S., I always prefer when lawyers call me than PR people. Anecdotally, over the years, I've done this for 11 years, and far more men, this is more gender, but it's race also, far more men call me up and pitch themselves for a story than women. I couldn't say race-wise. I don't have a sense on that. But I'm very clear, lots more men pitch me than women pitch me. And all four of y'all are current or have been GCs. And I'm wondering what y'all's experiences with women and people of color pitching you as opposed to white men.
I get pitched by everyone.
Well, you know, I don't... I'm hesitant because I don't want to hog the mic here, but you know, I learned a valuable lesson back in my days in private practice. I started practicing in my hometown in Pittsburgh, and the lawyer whose office was next door to mine eventually went off in-house, and I kept in contact with him and talked to him from time to time over the course of the years, and I never... it was a long time before I actually went to him and asked for business. And I don't know why, I probably bumped my head someday and said, okay, maybe I should just ask Jack for some business. I called him and asked him for the business. And he said, you know, I'm glad you finally got around to actually asking for the business. Well, it was an important lesson for me. And I think that it's challenging for people who are not used to asking for the business. And if there is a way, so I agree with your premise, if there is a way that to communicate, I want to say what the rules are, what the rules of engagement are. It's a lot, it's really hard to win the game if you don't know all the rules. There's a way to communicate what those rules of effectiveness are. We can make a lot of progress. And by the way, I think whenever somebody calls you and says they ride the unicycle, you should put them on the cover.
Yeah.
That's right.
Exactly. That's a rare thing.
Well, I get pitched by a little bit of everybody, but to your point, women have in the past seemed to have a harder time with it. I've been in-house since 1996 when I joined the National Basketball Association. And so when I tell you I was pitched by a lot of men, I was pitched by a lot of men. But what I would say to women at firms is, why don't you ask me? And I would allow them an opportunity to role play with me. So I find that some women just need the practice of, let's switch chairs and you pitch me and I'll show you how a pitch sounds, because I believe a lot of women don't get to attend those kinds of pitch meetings, or they certainly didn't in the mid-90s when I started out along this road. And so it was a great opportunity, especially with younger women lawyers, to pose the question, why don't you ask me? You know me. You go to church with me. You do other things with me. Why don't you pitch me? And it was a great opportunity to see that a lot of women didn't ask because they didn't know it was okay and they didn't know how. So it was an opportunity for us to teach and to go beyond mentoring to being a champion, where you're pushing someone beyond just the day-to-day mentoring.
Good point. Now, just to add, you know, to what Cathy and Rick have said, you know, in terms of, and we have, you know, it's interesting, I thought about that. Other than the fact that there are fewer women partners in law firms, and we all know that, and that's kind of what this is all about. You know, we have quite a number of women who are the relationship partners for our business, and, you know, get pitched quite often by women. But I do think it helps, you know, the sort of what are the rules, and I think the fact that, you know, I hope people out there know that diversity is important to us, and also our women and minority-owned business spend is important to us, and that we're actively looking to develop relationships with women partners in minority and majority firms. So hopefully that opens the door a little bit, or makes it feel a little bit more comfortable, I guess. So.
Well, and let me just add this too, and especially since I'm no longer sitting general counsel, I can say this. So for those women who are in the audience who are reluctant to make a pitch, don't be. I guarantee you, and as someone who's no longer sitting general counsel, I heard so many more bad pitches than good pitches that you shouldn't feel that there's a standard that you have to meet before you can go make that pitch. Practice, okay? Get the bad ones out of your system and go after it.
That's right, your elevator speech.
I want to add something to that. We place lawyers with law firms and corporations, and my practice is predominantly in the GC, Associate General Counsel level space. And oftentimes I'll call women and say, Allegra, would you be interested in this awesome GC role? And Allegra wouldn't do this because I know her, but oftentimes, when I'm speaking to a woman, they'll say, well, let me tell you why I don't think I'd be good for this. But when I call men, they tell me why they're good for it and why they should be the only candidate. I do think there's some gender differences. So I want to encourage women to speak up and not tell me why you're not qualified. Tell me why you are.
Hi, I'm Susan Campbell with Major Lindsay in Africa. My question relates to associations. Lawyers are very busy, and a lot of them give a lot of time and effort to some great organizations. And we have 27 nonprofit legal associations just in the Atlanta area. And we have some lovely representatives from the State Bar, former presidents of the Atlanta Bar, et cetera, in our audience tonight. My question is, what are your thoughts? I mean, should we be putting people together? What are your thoughts on kind of the minority bar associations? And do you think that the next generation coming up is going to change the dynamic of whether those organizations should remain subsets or whether they should be putting folks together?
Good question. Tom, how do you feel about that?
Well, I mean, we're all a product of our own experience, and I've shared my experience about the minority bar associations with you. I think you raise a really good question about the fragmentation of nonprofits, the fragmentation of all the, I guess now, countless diversity organizations, you know, causing, as Rick noted, you know, them to respond by saying, oh, one more. I think there's also implied in your question, will social networking and more access to internet web data change how the next generation looks at this? I don't have the answers to these things, but I think that's a provocative, good question. It'd be fertile ground for somebody to
address at next year's session. But in the meantime, I was at a luncheon event here in Atlanta not recently where one of the honorees raised this question very persuasively. It caused me to think for the next week constantly about this question, same question you asked. And I concluded that until somebody comes up with a better mousetrap, so to speak, the more the merrier. And if it means they're fragmented and you have to look a little harder to find them, you know, I'd be willing to deal with that. But
just a thought on that. It made me think about what we do at our company, and we're actually expanding our business resource and affinity groups rather than contracting, because I think the more opportunity people have to, I mean, what we found, the more opportunity that people have to share experiences and to network, it raises engagement. And you know, so I look at these organizations that we have a really good relationships and a lot of people very active with the MBA and the MCCA and AmWolf and those, and you know, and they serve as a great resource for us. So I don't know that I could comment at what point are they less relevant or whatever, but just from our experience at our company, there seems to be a real benefit to having these affinity associations.
Can I just add one thing? It just occurred to me as I was thinking about Brian and Nicole and our lawyers at Walmart. Before long, we had waiting lists of 20, 30 lawyers out of that 176 who wanted to go to HNBA, NAPABA, NBA, NAHL, or whatever. And it's not because people viewed those as ways to get out of the office, although it is a good way to get out of the office. Those were work trips, recruiting trips. We were sending 20 lawyers to those organizations for those meetings for 3 or 4 days. And we got more done at those meetings than we could have possibly gotten done elsewhere, because especially in Bentonville, Arkansas, but even in Atlanta, I mean, if you go do 20 lunches, how long does that take? But if you're in Phoenix at a NBA meeting and you're committed to getting the most out of the meeting, you're going to spend every waking hour, getting to know somebody in a face-to-face personal kind of way. And that's why I say again, diversity is a gift that keeps on giving. It just builds on itself and builds on itself. And next thing you know, you've got your whole law department vying for the opportunity to go to the next minority bar meeting.
Okay, I'd love to take more questions, but we have a dessert and coffee gathering right outside that we would welcome you to stay and to interact with the panelists. They volunteered to stay with us. So why don't we give them a big round of applause and thanks.